Greetings, War Thunderers. This is Longshot with you again. Welcome to my tutorial on flying the Bell P-400 Aerocobra in arcade. This plane is actually a P-39D, and like other P-39s, was a revolutionary design with the engine mounted behind the pilot, which left plenty of room in the nose for heavy weaponry. The Aerocobras quickly earned a bad reputation, with pilots afraid that it would start a flat spin in certain manoeuvres. Therefore, the P-39s were mostly slated for export under Lend-Lease, and as a result were given only a single-stage supercharger that restricted performance above 3,500 metres. A batch of P-39s were fitted with 20mm Hispanos instead of the usual 30mm cannon, and exported to England in 1940. They quickly shipped them off to Russia, but 200 remained in the States and were sent to New Guinea, where they served on the front line against the Japanese invasion. These planes were known as the P-400, and the US pilots referred to them simply as Clunkers. They had two nose-mounted 50 cals and four 30 cals in the wings, in addition to the cannon firing through the spinner. Although they were assigned to ground attack and reconnaissance, they did indeed face off against Zeros and held their own. So it wasn't that bad a plane, but how does it fly in War Thunder? First, let's look at the roll speed, and it's fairly slow, but I've certainly seen worse. Next, I'll bank and turn with the elevators. And you can see how slowly it comes around and how wide the turning circle is. Many bombers can turn more sharply than this plane. On the other hand, while retaining its speed quite well, you certainly don't want to be using elevators in a dogfight situation. This is not a turn fighter. So it has average ailerons and poor elevators, so how about the rudder? To see whether it's stronger or weaker than the elevators, I simply need to hold both rudder and elevator keys together, and as you can see, the plane pulls to the side far more than it pulls upwards. And this tells me that the rudder authority is quite strong, and I'll be showing how to exploit that later in the video. So as the Clunker is a lousy turn fighter due to its elevators, I need to see whether it's any good as an energy fighter. And the main things I want to test are its handling in a dive, and its energy retention in a zoom climb. And what I'm looking at here is the roll rate at high speed. And it remains the same at 600 kilometers an hour as at 300, so that's a good start. Note how the plane shudders as I elevator up out of the dive. If I was flying a real plane that did that, I'd be scared that it was going to fall apart. Now, as I started that dive from 2,500 meters and pulled out at 700 meters, and by the time I'm back at my starting altitude, I'm still traveling at 250 kilometers an hour. This thing is an excellent zoom climber. And getting close to stall speed, which is near 100 kilometers an hour, so I flip the plane over into another dive, this time to look at the rudder. The degree to which it stiffens up will have a large bearing on whether you can easily adjust your aim to follow targets in a diving attack. It's progressively losing its authority, but even above 600 k's there's still some response when I hit the rudder keys. So this plane looks like it'll be a fairly good boom and zoomer, however might start to struggle to track targets above 500 kilometers an hour or so. So, in War Thunder, this is indeed an energy fighter. It's fast, handles pretty well in a dive, and has a great zoom climb. So it's time to go to battle. I'm using stealth belts for the cannon and the 30 cals, and for the 50s I have ground attack, with my convergence at 400 meters. First thing I'm going to do after spawn is climb, and climb hard. The game gives us well over 300 k's, so I'm going to convert that to altitude straight away with a very sharp angle. And when the speed drops to around 270 k's, I'll drop down the nose to just under 30 degrees in order to keep the speed near 260 kilometers an hour. Any faster, and you're not climbing as fast as you should be, any slower and the plane starts to struggle. When WEP runs out, I drop the nose to keep it around the same speed throughout the climb, and then lift it again when the WEP cuts back in. Note that I'm climbing at a sideways angle to the battle. I don't know what other planes are climbing, and I don't want to take unnecessary risks with a direct head-on merge. All I'm interested in right now is managing my speed and angle of climb. And once the second WEP starts, I begin to look around and see what's going on. The enemy icons should start appearing soon, but as the skies are clear in this battle, I can see dots for climbing fighters and for the bombers above. At some distance away, there's a P-38, but so far he's the only climber. My WEP expires, and I've passed 4,000 meters. The Clunker has extremely good climbing abilities, and you should definitely make the most of them. From lower altitudes it can climb at an even sharper rate, but above 4,000 meters it starts to progressively lose performance, and by the time you reach 6,000 it's really struggling. There are several planes around its battle rating that have superior high altitude performance, including P-38s, Hellcats, P-47s, MiG-315s, MC-202s, BF-109s, Typhoons, Ki-61s and Ki-43s. Be very careful about taking those planes on unless you have a clear energy advantage. In this battle, the P-38 is not my only challenge, there's also a MiG-3. However, they've flown off and left me free to attack this Beaufort. And that's the first thing I'm going to look at, hunting bombers. Obviously the later era Cobras are more suited to this task with their 30mm cannon, but the P-400's weaponry is certainly enough to deal with most of the bombers you're likely to meet. Beauforts and Blenheims are quite fragile, however they're also fairly fast and manoeuvrable. This guy quickly ducks underneath me, which restricts me to a short burst, after which I have to climb, as the P-38 has reappeared. I need to ensure that I have an altitude advantage to avoid a head-on and give me options in how to engage, and as you can see, that's paid off. He's chosen to ignore me, so I'm able to slide into a diving attack. This demonstrates the need to deal with enemy fighters at altitude first. You simply can't afford to ignore them in favour of hunting bombers, as that P-38 is doing. When I get into firing range, note how the aiming reticle jumps around from the recoil. Due to its sluggish elevators, this is not the easiest plane to keep on target. You need to use zoom where possible and take care in lining up your initial burst. Try not to fire the cannons for a long time, as I just did, as most of the shells will spray off target and you don't have a huge store of ammunition to play with. And with that, high altitude appears to be mine. The Beaufort's disappeared, so I'll take on the approaching Heinkel. I've dropped below him to encourage him to climb, and then I can aim a careful burst as I attack from the side. This rarely kills bombers outright, but it's usually enough to either cripple them or force them to dive. Pulling up into a high yo-yo as I watch to see what he does, and then I can start another attacking pass. Hapless Heinkels have terrible gunners, and they're rarely a threat. They're basically a free kill. Going to finish this guy off using the machine guns while the cannons reload. The Beaufort's returned. I'll skip a part where he turned to avoid me below, eventually straightened up and I could dive to attack from above. And as you can see, the guns on this plane aren't bad. And that's despite many cannon underperforming due to a bug in how the game handles high explosive shells at the time of recording this video. The same guy's back in a Blenheim, and I must say he was quite an elusive pilot. The way to deal with a bomber that's more agile than you is to make long and fast attacking passes. They might outturn you, but you're quicker, and you must use that to your advantage. This pilot's trying to simply outrun me, but he hasn't a chance. You'd think a fuel tank fire followed by an engine fire would be a death sentence on a bomber, but no, he has plenty of time to return to his airfield and repair. That's the current state of War Thunder for you, I guess. Once he dives away, I'm going to let him go. I probably won't get a kill, but unless we're near the end of the battle, it's not worth it for me to pursue a target down to the ground and lose all of the altitude I've worked so hard to gain, just in the hope of scoring a single kill. The main thing is he's out of action and can't go bombing, and I'm free to look for new targets, such as another Blenheim passing directly beneath me. I use rudder and elevator keys to make the turn, while hitting WEP to keep my speed high, and then I can dive to attack from directly above. And this time there's no nonsense with fires, and the kill is quick and painless. So apart from the initial P-38, I've found it easy to just sit up here and feast on bombers, which are easy prey for this era Cobra and have allowed me to rack up 5 kills so far in this game. And for a while the bombers kept coming. I was a little low when I spotted a climbing Wellington, so I used the P-400's powerful engine to just helicopter up. The distance between us melts away and I'm able to hit him with a burst before I need to level out. I take care to stay beneath him, as I do, to make it difficult for his gunners to hit me. This guy was unusual in that instead of either diving away or simply ignoring me as many bomber pilots do, he tried to dogfight, and he started by climbing to maintain his altitude advantage as if he was in a fighter. He couldn't sustain it, so eventually we'd started to scissors, as he tried to make me overshoot, and as my speed was already low, there was no risk of that. But you can see how maneuverable that bomber is compared to my plane. He's almost flying circles around me. So I finally landed a brief burst that started an engine fire, after which he quickly gave up, and I was able to make a more conventional attacking pass, which of course chopped off the Welly's tail, despite it historically having one of the strongest airframes of any bomber in the war. Not in this game it doesn't. So that's hunting bombers. What happens though when the flow of high altitude targets dries up, and as in this game, everyone seems to be down on the deck? The best method I've found is to gradually descend and look for targets a little higher than the rest of the pack, like this MC-200. However, when you make diving attacks at a lower altitude, the rudder starts to stiffen up quickly. I'm over 600 kilometers an hour in the blink of an eye, and simply cannot follow that plane as it dodges around. I want to keep my energy advantage, which means giving up the attack and climbing again. So boom and zoom attacks are not easy in the P-400, but they can be done, you just need to choose your targets. For example, I saw these two guys off to the side of the map where they'd just killed a bomber and made sure they noticed me. And sure enough, they climbed up, which stalled them out. I forgot to zoom, so my aim was off and hence the F-2A escaped. But the MC-200, whom I'd unsuccessfully attacked earlier, was still interested. After another climb, I could see that he was struggling to keep up, so I dove in and this time, it was much easier to get the kill. So I'm getting this kill against a far more agile fighter by using the P-400's primary strength, its engine power and climbing ability. The 200's engines are not as strong, so it lost its speed and became an easy target. There was a joke during the war about this plane being a P-40 with a zero on its tail, and if you tried to dogfight an agile fighter, that would indeed be the outcome, but not if you fight on your terms rather than theirs. This is an example of a successful high-speed diving attack. The reason it works is that the target is preoccupied, so he's flying in a straight line and that allows me to make the shot. Importantly, I make sure to get behind him and align my wings with his, so that it gave me a long, steady firing window. It's a tactic you'll practice a lot in domination battles, where the vast majority of the action takes place at low altitude and there's rarely much to do higher up. I'm waiting around at 1500 meters for anyone flying below in a straight line, such as this A5M4 who's trying to cap our airfield. It's a shallow approach, so I'm using WEP to close in as fast as possible, then zooming in to aim my burst as carefully as I can from just outside convergence range. Then continue with WEP to gently climb away while checking around me for threats. Here's an I-16 on the tail of a friendly F-6F, and the Hellcat pilot is flying nice and straight, which makes my task much easier. The P-400 gains speed very quickly, which means I'm usually the first to arrive on the scene. The Ishak jinks around to avoid a diving lag, but he doesn't know I'm here until it's too late. Oh, and always check your cannon ammunition after firing, taking the opportunity to reload as you zoom climb. This is a more difficult example, where the lag under attack was jinking around, and that of course made the Ki-F-43 behind him dodge and weave, and I was lucky to even score a hit. While I'm zoom climbing, the lag might indeed be shot down, but I can only do what this plane's capable of, and hitting a jinking target at high speed is not something the Clunker's good at, nor are most energy fighters for that matter. Okay, I'm diving back down on a MiG, but he's aware of me and climbs to evade. But here's the same Ki-F-43, now travelling in a nice straight line. And that's easy. And I extend away before climbing in case the MiG's following me. The next example has a bit of a twist to it. It's a ground strike map where I'm diving on another Ki-F-43, but a friendly F-4F-4 is closer and sets him alight. As fires usually kill Hayabusas quickly, I bail out and spot a higher TBF over 3 kilometers away. And here's where the power of this plane's engine at low to mid altitude really shines. I have absolutely no trouble sustaining a long shallow climb to meet him at around 2000 meters, after which he promptly dives and I follow him down. To hit a diving plane, you have to lead the target by a greater margin than usual. In this case, I was unable to bring him down before he bombed our base. I used the machine guns to set him alight while the cannon reload. I don't follow when he pulls away to the left, but climb into a high yo-yo, from which I can start another diving pass and finish him off. I half expected this friendly I-15 to ram him, but on this occasion I was fortunate. I was at low altitude on this Grand Strike map due to the all too common layer of thick cloud that covered most of the battlefield, allowing bombers to hide and leaving nothing to do above the clouds. I don't want to try diving on targets swirling in the mid-map furball, so I'm extending forward, looking to intercept enemies en route to the battle. Here's a group of three that I've settled in behind. I choose the P-400 as it's closer, but can't land a hit before it breaks off. Then I switch to the MiG, aim carefully, and the job's done. Remember how easy it was to dive on the climbing planes I showed earlier on? You'll do a lot of that at higher altitude. Here I have a choice of two, but settle for the closer Ki-45. If I chose the MC-200, then I'd risk the 45 getting guns on me as I attacked. I set an engine alight, which probably won't get the kill, but forces him to dive away. Then I climb steeply with WEP and look around for the 200. And here he is. He forced a friendly Tiffy to dive and is now looking to climb back up, and that makes him vulnerable. This particular battle featured a convenient gap in the clouds looking down toward the enemy fighter spawn. I had a steady stream of fighters who'd spot me and climb on up, like this A5M4. I'm waiting until his climb rate pauses, which means his WEP has run out, and then I can dive in to attack. Even with 50% packet loss, that kill couldn't be stopped. One thing I haven't talked about yet is the rudder. Keen observers will already have noticed that I rarely tip the plane on its side to turn with elevators. Instead, I hold the rudder key to turn, tapping the roll keys as needed to keep the plane upright. Not only does it turn in a much tighter circle, it also hardly loses any speed. No, I don't imagine this is at all realistic, but it works for this plane and you should certainly use it to your advantage. For instance, here I have a BF-109 climbing up at me, and I'm waiting and watching for a dip in its climb rate. As I do so, I'm holding the plane flat and making tight turns with the rudder to stay above the target. When he's obviously struggling, I can swoop to attack, although my aim's off and I barely scratch his paint. So after climbing, I repeat the process. Waiting for him to reach me, turning with the rudder, and the 109 stalls. The rudder brings me around for a perfect shot, and a Corsair obviously thought I needed help. Thanks. Anyway, get used to turning like this and it soon becomes second nature in this plane. I'm going to show a range of other tactics now. On this occasion, I'm closing in on an I-16 that tried to climb off to the side of the battle. He ducks my bullets, so as I overshoot, I'm immediately going to climb hard. Now there's no way he can match my speed or engine power, and I'm out of his effective guns range. When the distance starts to increase, I know that he's stalling, so I can use the rudder to quickly turn the plane over into a diving attack. This is called a rope-a-dope, and it's incredibly effective. But the key is using the rudder to flip the plane over. You can see I was all prepared to repeat the tactic if the fire, that I'm about to set alight now, failed to destroy his plane. On this occasion, it does its job. Here I'm in a high-speed attack on a P-36 when Tracer flicks past, telling me that someone's followed me in the dive. And as I pull up, I see the Stuka that probably fired at me, but also a Hurricane chasing me up and closing in as he does so. I hold WEP and continue the steep climb, knowing that the cane will stall before I do. And once the distance starts to increase, I can flip the rudder over to attack. As it turns out, he hadn't quite stalled yet, but was unable to get guns on me properly, and that not only netted me a nice kill turning defense into attack, it also gave me the opportunity to continue the dive onto an IL-2. In effect, I used the rope-a-dope energy tactic to outturn a Hurricane with a P-400. I'm sorry to keep switching between battles. I tried to order the various engagements by the tactics used rather than showing one battle at a time. And yes, they're steadily getting more involved as I'm pushing the plane right to its limits. This features the pilot of the climbing I-16 from earlier, back for in a MiG-315 for another crack at forcing me off altitude. And this is one thing I really love about Arcade. You get to engage the same pilots again and again during the course of a battle, and at high altitude those duels are often tense and fascinating. Okay, so he ducked my initial diving attack, and I wasn't able to inflict critical damage during the brief firing window, so I immediately climbed to regain my altitude advantage. I have to level out as I'm near stall speed, and the MiG's having no problems climbing right up after me. In fact, he continues up and is obviously going to stall out, but my positioning is all wrong. Not even the rudder can bring my nose around fast enough to get guns on him. So there's an opportunity lost. And the problem with turning horizontally like that is now I no longer have an altitude advantage. My aim is now to continue the rudder turn to get on his tail, and I'm surprised to find he's climbed higher still, but obviously stalled out, which has forced him into a dive. Then I can hit him with another burst. Remember the fighters I listed earlier with superior high altitude performance to the Aerocobra? The MiG is one of them. Don't let its 1.7 battle rating fool you. It has climb and acceleration worthy of a Tier 3 plane. So because he stalled in his climb, I've been able to get behind him and we're in a rolling scissors. I deployed flaps to prevent any chance of overshooting, which makes it hard for me to follow his climbs, but I can hit him as he crosses my nose. I have a few firing opportunities I don't take, and I just need to be patient. My cannon have now reloaded. See how hard it is to lift the nose with these elevators. But here's a burst that crits his cooling system, which would have killed his engine. He immediately stops maneuvering, and I can finish him off. Here's a tactic I often use to try and get people to climb up to me. I dive down a little, fly directly toward their spawn so I'm the first enemy they see, then watch for someone taking the bait. As soon as they do, I climb hard, wait for them to stall, and then pounce. In this case, the cloud made that pouncing rather dangerous, and I was lucky not to lose a wing. Another example of the same tactic. I've attracted the attention of a yak, so I'm climbing hard to get above him. From their point of view, you look like an easy target, as you're helicoptering up right in front of them, and it tends to make them rather greedy. In fact, behind the yak is another MiG, in this case the cannon-armed MiG-334, which has also decided to target me. So I've quickly reached 4,500 meters, which I know those guys can't get to without at least three WEP climbs, so I can level out, fly above them and watch to see what they do. They're definitely committed to climbing at me. Neither shows any hint of a second thought, so it's now a question of which do I attack first. I roll over into a dive just to test the waters, and the yak immediately pulls a split S. I ignore him and switch to the MiG, who also ducks underneath when I begin to close in. So I'm going to climb and see if they follow me up. Well, the yak has given up and dived away, but the MiG wants to fight. I continue my climb in order to reinforce my advantage and keep him low on energy as he tries to chase. Then turn to fly across his line of flight once more, using the rudder to angle the plane around and keep above him. I judge that his speed will be low and start an attacking pass, but it's not low enough and he's able to duck under my attack, and then immediately climb up behind me. However, I have more than enough energy from my dive to keep above him. And that's the key to this fight. While I hold the altitude advantage, I have the upper hand. Now he's directly beneath me, and this is looking more like a typical rope-a-dope situation. However, I pull the trigger to attack a little early and use elevators, not rudder, so my diving attack is a failure. Never mind, I can try again. And this time, I'm going to use rudder to flip over quickly and drop directly at his plane. But I'm waiting a little too long before I do so, and I miss the vital seconds when he was stalled out. So he ducks under my guns, and then goes into a sharp climb, and my poor elevators stop me from following him. But my energy advantage means I'm quickly above him and extending away. Now as he's closer, the rope-a-dope might actually work. Leaving him a little bit too far behind, so I'm ruddering over immediately, and yes, he has stalled, and this time I won't miss. Next we're off to a domination battle in which I'm making a high speed attack on this Heinkel. As I zoom climb away, I'm bounced by a P-36. This is another low tier plane with exceptional performance. Not only is it a brilliant low speed turn fighter with great elevators, it can also climb like a rocket, and it's very hard to get to stall. And I have one of these right on my tail, so I'm doomed, right? No, in fact I'm not. I'm still climbing with the up elevator key pressed, but also have the left rudder key down, and I'm tapping the roll key to stop the plane flipping over while powering away with the web. This is a climbing spiral, and the aim is to expose the other plane's lack of power and force it to stall while keeping above stall speed myself. It's very difficult, however, to get a hook to stall. He's obviously struggling to keep up as he hasn't been able to stay on my tail, and my rudder turn is in fact slowly cutting into his turning circle. He almost does stall there, so I overshoot, and immediately he scissors and I have to begin the process again. Instead, I decide to be more direct. I turn and dive underneath him in a shallow yo-yo. Then once WEP comes back online, I'm into a steep, straight climb. He of course pursues me, making this a rope-a-dope. And as I'm still pretty close to him, I have to jink around to avoid his guns. As I get near 115 kilometers an hour, we both stall at the same time. The advantage of being higher is that I'm suddenly the aggressor, and just like that, the battle is won. And I bet he's still wondering what happened. One more climbing spiral example before I move on. I'm attacking a Stuka D3 with no energy advantage because it's picking on the Corsair that stole my kill, helped me out earlier on. And the D3 quickly breaks and focuses on me instead, and I begin the climbing turn tactic. Now imagine that this is a D5 instead. The same performance as the D3 but with far more lethal guns. A Stuka can literally turn like a zero, but it can't hang with an energy fighter in a maneuver like this. You can see him start to fall behind as his energy store runs dry. I've just about got him dead to rights now, just need to bring the nose around and, well, gee, thanks mate. That's teamwork for you, I guess. So one final example. I keep saying how various planes will outperform you at high altitude, and none more so than the Hellcat. I've chased this guy for a while and we finally squared off at 6,000 meters, me with an altitude advantage. And as he passed beneath, I tried turning with the rudder, but watch how easily he loops over and almost immediately has me in his sights. I should have dived at that point, but tried to outclimb him, thinking he couldn't possibly have the energy to follow. I was wrong, I stalled, and I paid by having my plane turned into Swiss cheese. There's another thing this plane can't do, and it's rather obvious. It can't survive turn fighting in a low-level furball. Sometimes though that's all a battle has to offer, like this one, near the end where pretty much everyone was twisting and turning among the rocks, and all I could do was fly above and watch. So while the dogfight rages below, here's my summary for flying the Clunker in arcade. When I started recording footage, I had 16 kills and 7 deaths over 13 flights, many of them a year ago. The plane's been in mothballs in my hangar for a long time. Right now I have 180 kills and 14 deaths after flying it another 35 times. In fact, I use this plane as my primary weapon in the D521 challenge. The P-400 is awkward, it handles like a cow, but to me that's outweighed by its strengths. It has character. It's not the easiest plane to fly, but it's certainly fun and rewarding in its own way. And you will definitely learn how to energy fight effectively while flying this plane. As it happened, I didn't have nearly enough time for the 360 kills required to earn the 521, nor was the lottery kind to me. So I'm taking my revenge by hunting down every 521 I see, and let me assure you that the Clunker is more than capable of performing that role. Well, I hope you've enjoyed the video. I'll probably cover the Hellcat next after patch 1.43 drops, as it will have a new flight model. And until then, I'll see you in the skies.